Welcome to another episode of Carolyn Talks Television. I'm Carolyn Topol, and I'm here with my lovely co-host, Rachel Arnett.
Hello again.
And we are starting the new season, starting with the newest style of TV. We don't want to go back to the old days of just having three channels and their networks, although they do have some really good shows.
There are some really good shows, not to knock them.
Not to knock them. Yeah. But the world of streaming TV has hit it running in a big way.
Taking over in a lot of ways.
Uh-huh. And as we know, the Emmys will be coming up soon, and we're going to see a lot of shows that are not on those three networks, but are on the streaming channels. Now, there are a lot of streaming channels out there, and I know some of you watch them, and some of you may be uncomfortable about them. So we're going to start by giving a little definition, teacher time.
A little background.
And Rachel and I are both teachers in another life that we lead outside of the studio, which, yeah, we actually do walk out once in a while.
Not often. No. I sleep here.
Really? I sleep right back there.
We should say hi.
Hi. But streaming media. Now, this evolved from the birth of the web series. Really, from YouTube.
Yeah.
YouTube started it, where people used to put up the family video, everybody waves hi, wave at the camera, and now we can post it so everybody in the entire world can see us waving hi at the camera. Well, that was a very, very, very quick evolution, because YouTube went from that simple post what you videoed in your private life to creating stories.
To original content. A lot of times it was parody content before. People would put on their own version of whatever show it was. And then it really, in the last like 5-10 years, started to become original content and not just talking heads.
And that is what has created the beginning of a true, true snowball effect. Because we started with YouTube, which does have original programming and also has brought in their own almost video rental service. I mean, this is something that also is one of the reasons you don't see a Blockbuster on every block anymore, because you could do that through YouTube if you didn't have certain channels on your TV. Now you can do that. You could rent a movie through YouTube, and that was something they started also. But they also did this web series concept. People would create their content, write an actual show, and share it, and they weren't restricted by time, except what they all put on their own restrictions.
And it was their choice or not, their choice on how they wanted to include advertising, monetize in their own way. So some people, it's just product placement. You'll see them wearing, you know, the hat or whatever it may be. And some people are actually having
When you see the polo pony on someone's, you know, logo on their shirt, it's not a mistake that they wore that shirt. They did that on purpose. And they were hoping to get some attention from that.
And quite a few people have made millions of dollars.
YouTube has really done that. And then what happened was the evolution of you could now literally watch shows as they are downloaded onto these networks. Because they really are like their own networks now. I don't even want to call them like little channels. They're not little channels. No. These are big, huge developments. Groups. And we're going to start with one that many people know because it's now even being absorbed into some of the cable company offerings and their packages, which I'm one of those who just recently changed my package in cable, and this was an offering. So I now actually pay for Netflix.
Which started as a DVD service, which now, and that used to be what you got. It started as you rent three DVDs, then you watch them and you send them back, and now it's almost, it's not entirely exclusive, but I would say the majority of people just watch it on their PlayStation or whatever is connected to their TV.
And that's why I was so excited. I'm like, oh, well, now I don't even have to pay two different services. My cable has absorbed this as an offering, and look what I can do now. I just, you know, flicking channels, and it's part of my service, and I could do my search, and it will show me my Netflix shows.
Yeah. And again, there was this evolution from, they used to be a showcase for other people's work, or after a show would be on
That's
TV
right.
for a while, then it would go on there, or movies, really, was where Netflix started. And now Netflix has its own original content. Movies, comedy specials, TV shows.
Series. Can we even
call them series? Yeah, series. We can't call them TV shows anymore.
They're not one-offs. They're truly series. And so we're going to start with a couple of Netflix series that I'm sure most of you have heard of, because they have been recognized by the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences with Emmys and Emmy nominations. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not talking about the, you know, stepbrother over on that other channel. They really are in the mix. One of the earlier shows that got huge, huge backing all over the place was Orange is the New Black.
Which just came out with its sixth season. And I'm just about halfway through it now, and I watched 5 episodes yesterday. It's fine. I'll be okay. It wasn't a full binge. I gave myself time. I got up and walked the dog, but it is.
And the dog, I'm sure, is grateful.
Yeah, the dog. He was ready.
He was ready. Okay.
He had the baleful eyes for a while. It is just a fantastic show. And I think with any show that goes more than 2 seasons, it's got, you know, it hits little bumps. And it hits areas where you feel like maybe they're going in the wrong direction, or they're following a character you're not interested in, or the plot's just not connecting. The last 2 seasons, for me, have really shored back up what the show was about in the first place, which is these are women's lives. And it follows prisoners in Litchfield Correctional Facility. It's originally a minimum security prison, although now they're following people in maximum security. Mm-hmm. And it's just, it's about them and what they go through. And the show does so many things for me. It talks about racism. It talks about sexism. It talks about harassment. It talks about homophobia. It talks about the need for criminal justice reform. And it talks about all of these things, and now it's going to be talking about immigration as well. And they really stay topical in something that's kind of hard to do when it comes out once every 1.5-2 years.
And that's the other thing, is they're not restricted with the old version of the TV year, which used to be sometime in mid to late September through May. And then you'd have the repeats. That was the old framework, almost like a school year.
Yeah.
TV year was a school year.
And it still is in a lot of ways.
And if you go on major networks, it certainly is. But now they'll frequently drop a show when they know that the major networks are in their repeats, because they still use that pattern. The other thing the major networks don't do, which even helps these streaming services more, is they don't always do repeats. Mm-hmm. Because they know that you can use that concept called on demand. And if you've seen it and you've paid for it already because it's part of your internet cable package, guess what? You can watch it as many times as you want to within a certain limited number of months, years, or whatever. So the repeat cycle is not what it used to be.
And I think the other thing that's different is because these shows are not on the traditional networks, they're not bound a lot of times by the politics of the traditional networks. And a lot of these online streaming services are giving them more freedom to touch on topics that they wouldn't be able to touch on, to use language or show things that would come with a warning or only be shown at 10 or 11 o'clock at night, but now are shown because if you're signing up for the streaming service, they'll say, you know, 18 or over, but it's really up to you at that point.
That's
to
right.
Give access. And almost every single time one of these shows on one of these streaming services wins an award, they say, thank you for being the place that would let us tell a story that we can't tell anywhere else. And with Orange is the New Black, they've done that consistently. Where they did one of the scariest things for me with any TV show ever. They killed off one of the most popular characters ever on that show. Like, she was the one character that nobody could hate. Everybody loved this character. And they killed her off, and they did it for a reason, to talk about police brutality. And they had to choose this character because they knew everyone, whether you were a supporter of Black Lives Matter, whether you were a supporter of criminal justice reform, whether you were part of Blue Lives Matter, would realize that this character that everyone connected with was affected. And it opened the conversation.
And you so rarely have seen that on network television.
Where they don't try to over-politic it and show
Right.
Both sides are really struggling. Like, maybe not. Maybe sometimes just one side's struggling. And they can do that on Netflix where they can't do that.
And they can also say things on Netflix. Mm-hmm. That's the other thing. You know, I am not what I would consider a potty mouth. But I actually have heard a swear or two in my life. And guess what? You would never hear that on network television because you can't. And there are some channels on television now, some of the cable channels, yeah, that even bleep out old shows that include very basic...
Benign words
to this day that were accepted in the 1970s that are showing... I mean, I've actually seen, and this one really... Okay, get ready for your daily chuckle. There was a bleep out on the Waltons. Yes, there was.
The Waltons.
Because it was on a TV cable channel called Inspire.
Ah.
And clearly, there are certain words you can't say there.
On TV networks called Inspire.
Inspire. Yeah. So having a Netflix and the others we are going to talk about really opens the door to see real life.
That's exactly it. These shows, I think, are more reflective of our reality because they're not bound by all of these barricades that are thrown up of you have to be politically correct and you have to make sure not to be too political and you have to make sure to show all of the sides all of the time. And I think that that gives us more of a sense of what people's realities are really like.
And people's realities are flexible and go up and down, and people win who shouldn't always, and people win who should. Mm-hmm. Another one on this I'm going to pop into because I know that this is what got my mother-in-law involved in Netflix, because for her, each time something like this came through, she was beginning to feel a little challenged by having everything in the world of communications literally being thrown at us. Mm-hmm. Every year, something more was being thrown and you had to augment and change. And after a while, it does get overwhelming. You start to hit that point.
You're like, no more technology. Please give me the turning button.
Right, I want to go back and get up off the sofa and just go click once and I'm done. But what brought her to Netflix? Grace and Frankie.
Which I admittedly have not seen yet. It is in my queue, and it's been in my queue, unfortunately, for a couple of years. I'm watching like 17 shows right now, so I just haven't gotten there yet.
Really? Shame on you.
I know.
But when you put Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin on a television show in the 2000s, mm-hmm, and then, rather than giving it to ABC, NBC, CBS, mm-hmm, or Fox, or anywhere else, you actually go to Netflix, and this is a Netflix original series, you end up with incredible ratings.
And prestige. It brings it to a new level, really.
It does. It elevates Netflix, because this says, yeah, we're valuable, we're important. And if you haven't seen Grace and Frankie, it's a great show. It's a show about two friends who become friends due to their husband's betrayal in the first season. And it's a betrayal that's a twist at any age, but at the age that these four people are in, it's even funnier. It's funnier and a little eye-opening, and it's thrilling to get to watch. And
I've always heard amazing things. It's my mother watches it. I can hear her laughing hysterically from the other room. And I've seen brief moments, and it seemed really well put together and funny. I just haven't gotten there yet.
And if we've seen Lily Tomlin do funny, and we've seen Lily Tomlin do serious, mm-hmm, and we've seen Jane Fonda do both, can you imagine putting these two women together?
Powerhouses and, of cinema.
And they said this is where they want to go. They could go anywhere. They could.
Oh, yeah. They could.
When you say, I could write my ticket, they're the people who could say, I can write my ticket.
Yeah.
This is the ticket they wrote. They walked into Netflix. Yeah.
And I think it's great that shows like Grace and Frankie are paired with other shows. I think, you know, you have Orange is the New Black and Grace and Frankie, which seem to me like very, very different shows. Mm-hmm. Both with kind of this thread of comedy sensibility and real life. But then you also have the Marvel series that Netflix... I'm a huge Marvel Cinematic Universe fan and Marvel fan in general. And there are now 5 Marvel series and I think another one in the works. And it started with Daredevil, moved to Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, Iron Fist, The Defenders, The Punisher.
These are the ones I let Rachel watch.
Yes, she doesn't watch them. It's fine. That's fine.
Which is all good, because that's why it makes it a good network, because it's got stuff for everybody.
That is not for you. It's totally for me.
And the geek in me was overwhelmed with joy when Fuller House played on Netflix, because I actually remember watching the show with my daughter, who is now a married woman on her own for several years. I will not say her age, because I'm going to be polite and not say her age, and not, then you wouldn't know my age.
So that would be like the puzzle piece to help figure out your age.
Yes, it would be.
All right.
So we're just leaving that.
No Easter eggs? No.
No Easter eggs. Nothing's happening here, folks. But she and I watched it when she was a really little girl.
Oh, I remember watching Full House and all the time.
Watched it all through the entire original series.
Yep.
So this coming back is like a whole generational shift. But people like me, who are of an age of, and I'm not yet, but who are of the age of people who are starting to be grandparents of little tots, can watch it with them. And so can the parents who watched it originally watch it with their children and see the same characters. It's a hoot. It's nostalgic. Do I think it's going to be up for an Emmy? Nope. I'll be honest.
No. But no. I don't think it was aiming for that.
Exactly. It was aiming for nostalgia and fun viewing for families. And guess what? They hit it again. They hit it with Full House, and they hit it with Fuller House.
And the first season was very referential of Full House. They over and over again, like, mercy, cut it out. Like, all of the old jokes were there, and just to remind you, hey, we're here. But I think you were saying the second season, for you especially, it really took
it off. It sort of took off on its own, and it had its own story development. Do I think it's long, like it's going to be a Grace and Frank? No. Do I think it's going to be an Orange is the New Black? No. But I do think it's got maybe one more season in it if they go for it. And the other thing about this is there's not like this contractual, you have to have this many seasons.
Yeah.
There's a lot of flexibility.
And most of the time with streaming series, it's one season at a time.
And they make the decision afterwards, how did it go? Let's do another. I would like to move on, because we've been on Netflix for a little bit, to Hulu. Hulu, which started for me on my computer. And you could see something you may have missed that was on the air 3 hours earlier, and it'll show up on Hulu for 5 days.
Yeah, and that was really their business model originally, was that same thing where you missed the TV show, this is where you watch the TV show. They made a deal with the networks and said, we'll show it for 5 days, like you said, and then it's gone. And that's evolved too.
And now some of their original series, also Emmy Award winners, we have The Handmaid's Tale.
Just finished the second season. I just finished it.
Which is probably one of the most brilliant, heart-wrenching, difficult
terrifying
shows to watch.
Yeah.
But its value, its production value, it's not like they're doing, this is not the original YouTube kind of, let's do it in the living room or the basement.
With the GoPro and the
and
a flashlight. Like,
exactly. No. This has got production value, a lot of exterior. This is a big deal. This is a big deal show with a lot of emotion and a lot of, once again, quality acting. You are not getting the person who wants to be on their first TV show getting hired for this. These are seasoned actors on this show. It also included, rather than just only do that, they opened their door to another original thing by doing one of your favorites, the last season of The Mindy Project. Do you want to talk about that?
Mindy Project was one of my favorite shows that I've ever seen.
On Network TV.
On Network TV. It started, and it was brilliant, and it was funny, and then it just didn't have the ratings. But it was one of those shows that I could always turn on and always laugh, and it was just wonderful. And when the show went off the air, I was devastated because I needed to know how it finished. It was kind of along the lines of when I think it was Ally McBeal, they were like, oh, we are going to give it one more season, but we may not finish it. And I was like heart-wrenched. And for Mindy Project, it was saved by Hulu. And they finished out that last season. And you could see that the tone was different because they were able to do a little bit more.
And they were able to wrap up their story.
Yeah.
The nice thing was Hulu let them, with their original programming, make the story end truly in a way that it was supposed to.
Exactly. And the other thing that Hulu does, which is different, Netflix tends to drop its shows all at once. All 13 to 26 episodes, bam.
Yes.
One day, which really enables the binge watching.
Right.
Hulu, for its big shows, Handmaid's Tale, Mindy Project, and even Marvel's Runaways, another Marvel show, which right. hopefully you'll check out at some
okay.
point. It's week by week again. So they won't do, so it works similarly to network TV in
right.
that way, but it's just on another level. You can't do The Handmaid's Tale on
And then anyone. On top of everything else, while Amazon is now helping Whole Foods,
yeah.
Amazon is also has their Prime Video network. And they have shows like Transparent, once again, an Emmy winner. But they also have shows like that they've adopted that are soapy. They have a sort of a niche market on Amazon, too.
Yeah.
For those people who really want to see their soap stars doing more. So they have shows like Ladies of the Lake, which just dropped its second season. And those are very short seasons.
Yeah.
Each one of those, I think the first was 4, the second was 3. So you could literally watch them as like little TV movies.
Yep.
Which makes them more fun because you can binge watch without devoting half a day. Which
yeah,
for someone like me was great.
Yeah.
And I know the stars because I like soap operas. One that's been going on for a number of years and has won several daytime Emmys is The Bay, which started so long ago. It started on something called blip.tv. It was a web series. But Amazon Prime picked it up, I believe, in 2015-16.
Mm-hmm.
And they are now doing seasons on Amazon Prime. So I think I'm pretty caught up on that. But once again, it's a soap-like show with a lot of over-the-top drama happening to the core characters.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're a soap person, you'll also see some of your favorite soap stars who do this because the taping for an entire season is going to be in a really concentrated period of time. You don't have to stretch this out over 8 months.
Yeah, which it's funny because I'm so used to it with network TV, but with Handmaid's Tale, I somehow this season forgot that they did that. So I got to, I think something like the 10th episode because I missed for quite a few weeks. And I went, wait a second, the series just, like that's how the series ends? And then I said, wait, no, it doesn't. There's more.
There's more that's going to
come. But I got so used to the Netflix model of just watch it all at once. That there was almost this frustration.
Right. There was. It's
my
not
generation
a drop.
Has no patience anymore. We
yeah,
want
really.
To know what happened now.
Yeah, not everybody drops the series.
I know. And it was almost painful to wait and see what happened.
Now, I want to make sure, as we're going through this, that you all know that most of these streaming services still have fees.
Absolutely.
You know, this isn't like free, like you could turn it on and go for it. There will be fees. But considering the quality of it now, my personal opinion, so truly only my opinion, is I find it worth it because they have quality programming.
And
5 years ago, I don't know that I would have said the same thing.
And I got to tell you, most of my students now, when they go to college, they're not signing up for TV packages anymore. They're almost exclusively Netflix, Hulu, and Amazon Prime. And especially because you can still watch network TV shows a lot of the time.
Yes.
Or on apps for the
there's
actual
live
networks.
Streaming, right, there's live streaming apps. Yeah. For networks.
Yeah.
I want to make sure to put in a little plug because we might go back to our subject, but I just
Absolutely.
I don't want to forget. Last year, one of the first things we talked about in one of our first episodes was Einstein.
Yep.
In fact, I think it was in our first episode.
Yeah, it was Genius. Yep.
Genius on National Geographic. And one of the things I was excited about was that my brother-in-law, Rachel Topol, was one of the co-stars of that show, that
mm-hmm.
series. And I tend to be very excited when I hear he's got things going. Frequently he's on stage, which means that I could say, great, go see his show. But in this case, we recently got word from Richard that he will be, at least at the beginning, in a new NBC TV show called Manifest.
Which looks so cool.
It looks creepy cool.
Yeah.
It's about an airplane that shows up at its destination airport 5 years later than expected.
And they have no idea that time has passed. They're very confused based on the trailer as to why they're being greeted by police cars and the FBI
yeah.
and all of this.
And they have to be told, you've been missing for 5 years, presumed dead.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, for them, time doesn't seem to have passed. So it's fascinating in terms of their physical capabilities. This just looks really engaging. Some people have said, is this the new Lost? I don't see it as that because they're back. The first thing that happens is they've arrived. They are made to their destination. It's what happened getting them there.
Yeah, and I think it'll, my guess is that they're going to focus a lot on the people who weren't on the plane and how they may have or have not moved forward in that 5 years. So there's going to be kind of that castaway vibe, maybe, where for them it's only been, you know, a 3-hour flight, but the people in their life have moved on.
And to see how they can all once again reconnect. Can they reconnect?
I think there's a lot of character and emotional content that they can really delve into. It'll be interesting to see which direction they take it in.
I mean, I have to say, just from a commercial, this is not my brother-in-law's part of the show, but they even talk about the fact that one of the people on the flight was a young boy who had cancer and was in treatment, and his cancer hadn't progressed.
Oh.
So to me, that was like, for me, that was a hook.
Yeah.
That was a hook promo. So give it a shot. It's not lost. It's not lost. Take two.
No.
It's arrived. Take one.
Yeah. I like that.
Arrived, found, whatever you want to say. And
eventually you'll probably be able to watch it on Hulu.
There you go.
I think NBC has their partnership with Hulu.
Oh, is that who the NBC partner is Hulu?
I believe.
Now, our next show, Rachel and I have already talked about this because we've been waiting a long time to do this. We're going to really hit the premium channels, the ones that from day one, if you wanted to see it, you had to pay for it. Mm-hmm. HBO, Showtime, Stars, Cinemax, all those things that have had the perks of giving us literally big bang movies, blockbusters, in 6 to 8 months after they were in a theater.
Yep. And they for me were kind of the original place where you could go if your show was a little beyond the pale of what was expected.
I believe the word back then was racy.
Yeah, okay. I didn't want to say race. Yeah. Yeah, but that's where you went for shows like Game of Thrones, where nudity was a part of the story.
Right.
And you couldn't show nudity at 6 o'clock at night on NBC.
And you could see it repeatedly if you were really into Game of Thrones, which is a little hard to watch a lot. But I have to say, even for me, it started out years ago where I was able to see blockbuster movies in my home that I either missed in the theater or couldn't see. And now I think it's also changed theater life. But I'm not going to go any further right now.
We're okay. Really excited.
We're really excited to share that
episode.
I closed my
mouth and then immediately opened it.
But I do really, really strongly say, streaming is worth it. It is the future of television in a variety of ways. It delivers TV in a way that we can all enjoy it.
There's something for everyone.
In our own timeline, and there is something for everybody. So thank you again for sharing another episode of Carolyn Talks Television with Rachel and myself. We love seeing you again and look forward to another great year with you. So take care.